Our call to worship, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Our feet shall stand within thy gates, O Jerusalem.
For then thy courts is better than a thousand. I'd rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than to dwell in the tents of wickedness.
Because of the house of the Lord our God, I will seek thy good.
Those who repent in the house of the Lord shall flourish in the courts of our God.
Blessed are they that dwell in thy house. Lord, I have loved thy habitation, the place where their honor dwelleth.
For the Lord is in his holy temple. Let all the earth be silent before him.
Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer.
O sing to the Lord a new song, for he has done marvelous things. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all the earth sing his praise.
All the earth and all of St. Paul shall sing the praises of our Father, and the morning hymn of praise shall be the 122nd hymn that says, go tell it on the mountain.
Going to give us any more than we can bear. And we found out a long time ago that weeping may endure for a night, but that joy shall surely come in the morning. And in the morning, we're going to get up and be saying, happy birthday, Jesus. because he was born a second time that we celebrate. And we know that God is who he says he is. He sent his son down that we may have a right to the tree of life. Our Father God, here we are once more and again just to say thank you. Heavenly Father, we come thanking you for another opportunity. Heavenly Father, to look up toward the hills from which cometh our help. Because we know that our help comes from you, Lord Jesus. We come just to say thank you for our last night's lying down. Thank you for our early morning rising. Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord Jesus, that when we rose this morning, oh, Heavenly Father, we had the activity of our limbs. Heavenly Father, that we could come out to your house of worship just one more time. And Heavenly Father, we just thank you, Heavenly Father, for all of us, Heavenly Father, who came out to our Sunday school, Lord Jesus, that we had food ready for us, Lord Jesus. Heavenly Father, we just want to say thank you. And Heavenly Father, thank you for each home that is represented here on this day. But Heavenly Father, this is an awesome day, a day that you have made, a day we shall never see again. So we just want to say thank you. Oh, Heavenly Father, we just come right now, Heavenly Father, with bowed down heads and humble hearts. Heavenly Father, asking you, Lord Jesus, to go into the sick rooms, Lord Jesus. Heavenly Father, to go into the nursing homes. Oh, Heavenly Father, go into the behind the prison walls. Heavenly Father, let all know, Heavenly Father, that you're God and you're God Almighty and you're God all by yourself. Oh, Heavenly Father, when things get bad and they get well, we feel like we can't do anything. Oh, Heavenly Father, remind us that all we got to do is look toward the hills and say, and all we got to say is Jesus. Heavenly Father, you may not come when we want you, but you're always right on time. And for that, I just want to say thank you, Heavenly Father, for you are a good God. And Heavenly Father, I know, because of Jesus, can't nobody do us like you. Oh, Heavenly Father, we just ask you, Lord Jesus, just to accept this, our prayer, and bless the word that shall come forth today. May it convict and word and do what you would have it to do. Oh, Heavenly Father, that someone may come running and ask the question, what must I do to be saved? Oh, Heavenly Father, in Jesus' name I pray. Amen and amen and amen.
on, fellas.
Real meaning of Christmas.
It ain't about mistletoe.
Oh, oh.
Means to you, how many gifts will you go through? But it really doesn't matter if the gift is great or small. Without Christ, there's no Christmas at all. The real, hey, the real meaning of Savior, my deliverance, I'm glad about it. Yes, I am. Hey, if it wasn't for my Savior, come be down here. Hey, where would I be? Yeah, 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 yeah.
Holy night, holy night.
All is
bright.
That's the real meaning. Professor of the Lord, yeah, yeah. Mary. Oh, yeah. Hey, and it's all about Jesus. Hey, it's not the same. It's not the same, y'all. It's all about Jesus. Yeah.
It ain't the same,
though. without Jesus? Where would we be? It ain't the same. It ain't the same.
Several scriptures in the message today, but this is one of the background scriptures I want you to focus and remember. Philippians chapter 2. Philippians chapter 2. Beginning at the fifth verse, so verses 5 through 11. In your relationship with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who, being in the very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The Lord bless the reading, hearing, and doing of his most holy word from all that dwells below the skies. Fourth Sunday of Litany for our Advent service. On this fourth Sunday of Advent, we join in worship to celebrate love, recalling God's extended love to all peoples. God is love. God created love and gifted love. As we wait on the second coming of Christ, remind us, O Lord, that your love abides forever. Transform us in the power of your love. Let your love guide us whenever we think, speak, or act. Let us love each other as you have loved us. Beloved, let us love one another because love is from God. Everyone who loves is born of God and knows God.
Lord,
we thank you for the assurance that when nothing else can help, your love will provide the strength to carry on. May you kindle in our hearts the pure flame of your eternal love. Empower us so that we may walk in your light and your love. We light the candle of love today, proclaiming that our hearts are filled with your pure, everlasting, and all-encompassing love. Lord, as we wait and worship, may we be persistent in hope. May we pursue peace with passion. May joy overflow in us, through us, beyond us, and may you magnify your love in us beyond measure. Now and always, we pray. Amen. Glory. Happy Sunday, family.
Happy Sunday.
Oh, that's because God is good. And all the time? Well, y'all been in the black church. Amen. One of the pastor's favorite holidays is upon us. And thus, it's hard because on Sunday morning on pastor, on preaching, that's different from Bible study. That's different from teaching. You try and encompass all of it, but you really can't get in depth like we want to. So I try to incorporate something in our teaching moments and little tidbits. You know, back in the day, we used to come to church school, and we used to go to Bible study and open it up and stuff, but because of life and business, we all can't do that. But as I'm learning, how you practice is how you play. Don't say the church don't work. Don't say the Bible don't work. Don't say this Christian stuff don't work. Because how you practice is how you play. If you can't do it in practice, you're not doing it in the game. Amen. Y'all pray on that, and you hear what I'm saying. So what I'm trying to do is getting us to where we got practice. This is practice. This is, let's get into the word. Let's get into the plays. Let's get into exercise. Let's get into strengthening our passing, our running, our deflections, our defense, our offense. Let's run the drills. Some of the drills are not comfortable, but you got to do them. I used to didn't like long distance running. I hated it. Amen. Once I go around the track one time, I don't want to go again. Amen. What are you talking about 8 times? I ain't going no 8 times. But it builds up the cardio. It builds up your endurance because once you get tired, and when we sparred, when we got to fighting, ooh, I beat you up in 30 seconds. But after 30 seconds, whoo, that's how my punches are. Unless you build up the wind, the endurance, the breathing, and I used to hold my breath, you can't fight and hold your breath. You can't run and hold your breath. You know what's going to happen? You're going to pass out. Amen? Amen? So you had to learn how to breathe. You had to learn how to control. Well, if all that is true in the physical, guess what it is in the spiritual? So we get into the word of God. We get into the teaching. We get into what does this mean? How do I apply it in my life? And how do I incorporate it? It's one thing to learn a kata. A kata is a preset form of movements. Or to learn the technique. There's a front punch. There's a back fist. There's a side kick. That's one thing to do it. It look pretty. But guess what? In a fight, it don't look like that. Amen? That punch might do this. So it doesn't look perfect. As long as I hit the target and they go like this, ow, it did its job. Amen? where you might learn the prayer.
Oh, Father, help me, Jesus.
If the car almost getting ready to hit you, help me, Jesus! Now, that's a prayer right there. Amen. He heard that. Mm-hmm. So it's one thing to say the stuff, but it's another thing to put it into practice. What you want to do as you're coming, start putting it into practice. How do I pray this? How do I utilize this? How do I read the scripture? Don't just read it, pray it. After you read it, pray the scripture. Okay, now, the teaching moment also is this. We gave you Philippians, that's going to be the part of the sermon. This also is in 1 John, the Gospel of John chapter 1, Gospel of John chapter 1, verse 10. He was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. You see that in verse 10. John is already established in chapter 1 that he's talking about Jesus. That Jesus is the word manifested. That he is God, the spoken, visible representation of God the Father. That he is the Godhead. That he is the word manifested among us. That he is this light. The light of all mankind. And then he said he was in the world. He came. The first advent. He came. But the world, what did it say? Did not recognize him. But did you catch in verse 10? He was in the world, and though the world was made through him. That just blew my mind. And the passages I'm putting together are also in Philippians. He's being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant being made in human likeness. So the scripture is teaching Jesus is God manifested in flesh, that he came, right? That we're going to talk about his birth. Well, it's really his incarnation, that he came. He wasn't born like everybody else. He came through a woman, but he wasn't born like we were, right? Joseph, yeah, was his earthly father. But see, if y'all don't know basic biology, the children's, they comes from us. Amen? Y'all carry it. Yours blends, but it don't come from you. It comes from the Father. That's why he didn't have an earthly father. Because if he had an earthly father, he would have sin. He had a heavenly father. And the Father put it in Mary. Did y'all catch all that? Oh, shucky ducky. So this is just amazing once you start looking at the scripture and you start understanding what is it saying. So it's done told me just off those little couple of passages. When you be seeing all that Charlie Brown, all them Christmas show, and you see all them little baby in the manger, that baby is the one that made you. That baby was the one that made Mary. That baby was the one that put himself inside of Mary. That baby is the one, mama, I'm going to save you. I'm going to redeem and forgive your sin. That baby was the one that if there's any animals around, oh, they know who it was. Because that baby made them. That baby made everything. Because the scripture teaches he made everything through him. Who's the him class? There we go. Oh, y'all get an A for today. So, very powerful. Keep reading. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. That's verse 12 of John 1. He gave the right. Pastor, what are you saying? You didn't save yourself. You ain't good. You ain't gonna fool Pastor in thinking you holy and all that and of all the bag of trips, and I'm gonna let you go around thinking you got it all going. No, you a sinner. You're unworthy of anything. You should have been dead a long time ago. You ain't no better than me. You put your pants leg on one leg at a time, just like me. Your breath stink when you get up, just like me. Strange smells come from the bathroom, just like mine. Hair nappy, just like if I had hair. Amen. All of us had Afro Sheen and Sulfur 8. Amen. Ain't no one righteous, no, not one. And we didn't want to come to church. You heathen. You know good and well you ain't won't get up and go. Huh? But because of God's mercy and his grace, he gave the right, one, for you to understand, two, for you to say, I ain't right. Three, for you to say, Lord, help me, Jesus. I repent because I ain't right and I can't do this. He was the one that birthed in me and told me, I'm looking at the Ten Commandments. And see, Pastor on it, I can't keep none of these. I done broke every last one of them on a daily basis. Amen. Do you know how many people Pastor done killed in my mind? Oh, I'm the only one. Liar, liar, pants on fire. He said, if you got mad at him, you have already killed him. Who ain't been mad at somebody? And if you didn't raise your hand in spirit, you are a liar, liar, pants on fire. Amen. We all have sinned. But he gave the right. He gave the privilege. He says, I know you can't do it. I'm going to do it for you. Amen. All you have to do is trust me, is believe, and I'll put my spirit. Happy Sunday.
the precious Lamb of God. You love me so that I shall never know the precious Lamb of God.
Now behold the Lamb, the precious Lamb of God. Born into sin that I may live again. He's the precious Lamb of God. When I always didn't do right, I went left, he told me to go right. But I'm standing right here in the midst of my tears. Lord, I claim you to be my sin tore us apart.
As was stated earlier in our teaching moment, there are several passages of scripture. You have the scriptural reading from Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 through 11. You have also, for now, Isaiah chapter 9. Isaiah chapter 9. Verse 6, for unto us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, and Prince of Peace. And in a teaching moment, we had John, the Gospel of John, chapter 1. But I'm going to lift out one through three. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him, all things were made. Without him, nothing was made that has been made. The subject this morning for us out of those passages is simply when God became a man. When God became a man. For you see, there's a lot of teaching that needs to occur in our churches, and because we have, Hollywood has confused us. Most of the stuff you see in Hollywood is Roman Catholicism. It's Catholic. Amen? Catholic is different from the Protestant Christianity. Some big differences. But most of the stuff you see in Hollywood and on TV and in film is Catholic in the priesthood. You also see what cultures bring to the table. Feliz Navidad, Kwanzaa, Hanukkah. The list goes on, and we blend all of it like a cultural gumbo, if you will. But the true meaning of why we celebrate Christmas is the wonder and beauty and also the rejoicing. It has nothing to do with bells ringing or Macy's or Christmas parades or the things that you associate with Christmas. It has to do with God seeing what you could not do for yourself. Says, I'll do it for you. Because I'm the only one that can, but a human has to do it. So I have to come as a human. So we rejoice because he came. Jesus did not come into the world merely to bring peace and wonder and gifts. The true joy of Christmas is found in knowing that Jesus came to bring the message of life, a message of victory over death, meaning to life, and fulfillment of God's love. This Advent, we thank God for his coming. We prepare for his second coming. Because he's coming again, y'all. And it is not that we get wrapped up in the sales that are going on, but we get wrapped up with rejoicing in what God has purchased already and given gifts. It's not our fault you haven't opened your gift. It's not our fault you were too lazy to get up out of the bed and go downstairs and open the gift with everybody else. Amen. It's not our fault you let the tree set up all year long and your gift's still under the tree. And you mad at us because we playing with our gift. No, God clearly tells us in the scriptures the real reason why Christ came. The entire Bible is about Jesus from Genesis to Revelation. Amen. All of history is his story, all of it. Time even has his name, A.D. Amen? Every page is in types, symbols, and shadows. So John, that's why he's one of my favorite books of the Bible is the Gospel of John. In 1 John, because he gets to the point. He gets past all the genealogies. He gets past all this rigmarole about lineage and King David. And he says, in the beginning was the Word. I don't know what y'all talking about. All I know is he's the Messiah. He is God in flesh, manifested among us. And the Gospel of John explains the fulfillment of all those in the person of Jesus. John continues and he writes that God loved the world so much that he gave a gift, his son. So the theological term for what happened at Christmas, of why we celebrate, wasn't a birth, wasn't a baby. The theological term is incarnation. Incarnation, that word means to be made or to become flesh. Hence, the Lord Jesus is referred to by many as the incarnate Word. Not just the words on a page, not that the words that are just spoken, but he is the Word becoming flesh, incarnate. And the prophet Isaiah foretold of this incarnation by the Holy Spirit. He prophesied that the promised Messiah would be called Emmanuel, meaning God with us. Isaiah says, for unto us a child is born, a son is given. His name is Wonderful. He's precious to us that believe. He's Counselor. You got a problem? I suggest you go to Jesus. He is the Mighty God. Oh, that means he's all powerful. Ain't nothing he can't do. He is the everlasting Father. That means I'm his son. You his daughter. Amen. We family. Mm-hmm. And that he is the Prince of Peace. I don't have peace, Pastor, because you ain't got Jesus. If you want peace, I suggest you call on his name. See, the birth of Jesus, the incarnation, is called good tidings of great joy. It was good news. Jesus came to be a savior, to save us from our sin, sickness, and fears. But see, a lot of folk don't want to hear that. That's why they don't want to listen. because they don't want to hear it, because to hear it means something wrong with you. See, you got to admit you ain't right. And I hate fake folk. I hate folk be acting like they all that and you ain't never done nothing wrong. Looking at me like I'm crazy because you don't know what Mad Dog 2020. Nick, you know what Mad Dog is. Night Train 2. Thunderbird. Coke 45. Oh, don't be talking about some Cavassier. Oh, you, that's a cooler. Amen. Now I know I got some cooler people in here, so and Lil Zinfandel and Moscato. But for all my nearest green, Uncle Nears, for all my, give me some of that shine. Amen. The real folk. See, Jesus didn't come to play with the folk that think you all that. He came to the folk that said, Lord, I need help. He came to save. And that's why the Jewish prophet Isaiah wrote 700 years before Christ declared in our text, therefore the Lord shall himself give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son and shall call his name Emmanuel, which is God with us. The word Emmanuel refers to the presence of God. See, God's presence is not a new idea. He was given that back in the Old Testament. That's why in the garden, he walked with Adam. Amen. While Noah was busy building the ark, he was coming as an architect. Hey, you might want to put that right there and put this over here. Amen. Abraham, he walked with him and ate with him and says, boy, if you love me that much, bring me your son. His presence was manifested with Moses. The ground that you're standing on is holy ground. Take them sandals off. And the Shekinah of Christ came upon Moses. He was with Joshua and said, boy, just keep on marching around. Don't say one word. And on the seventh time, I need y'all to shout and blow that horn. And them walls are going to come tumbling down. And he was with Deborah when she led Israel to victory against Jabin's army. He was with Samuel. He was with David. He was with Solomon. He was with Elijah. He was with Elisha. God has been with his people. God has been with those that he has called and chosen and brought out of darkness into the light. So God's presence was not only visible with people, but God says, I've made my presence known. All you got to do is look up in the sky. When you look at the heavens, when you look at the stars, when you see the rainbow, when you see my handiwork, when you see the animals, and when you see the trees and the valleys and the waterfalls and Niagara Falls, and when you see the ocean and the waves, they are saying, yes, God is with us. So Christianity sets itself apart from every other religion, faith group, and cult. It is the only faith that proclaims with absolute certainty that God came from heaven on earth in the form of Jesus Christ. So in John's gospel, he begins by identifying Jesus as the Logos, the Word, the total revelation of God. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and he was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Through him. Who's him, class? Jesus. So that young carpenter, yeah, Yeah, he built it. You mean that young child that went to the temple when he was set? Yeah, him. You mean the one that the shepherds came and gave gifts? Yeah, that one right there. You mean the one that Elizabeth and John the Baptist on the inside of Elizabeth started jumping around and started doing this when his Lord started coming in the... Yeah, yeah, him. So John's focus is on the central fact of our faith. Christianity is not a philosophy. It is not a religion. It's about a person. That person is fundamental to our faith. You remove Jesus from Christianity, that's like taking numbers out of math. Air out of breathing. To sun out of daylight. to strip Christianity of its most essential component. John says, no, no. So that's why John's whole thesis of writing this gospel was found in chapter 20 and verse 31. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God. And that by believing you may have life in his name. That's why Jesus is the most astonishing individual in human history. More books have been written, more music composed, pictures painted, and dramas performed about Jesus than anybody else. Jesus looms large in society as he did over 2,000 years ago. He is the most powerful personality to ever appear on this planet, and well should he be. And that's why he says the Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. God has arrived. Prophecy has been fulfilled. So the angels announced to the shepherds, today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ, the Lord. The Word became flesh and dwelt among us. That's why we celebrate. That's why I come to church. Because I met a man named Jesus. Amen. Now I understood what Daddy was talking about. He'd turn you from center to circumference. I used to be young. What the heck are you talking about? Then I started remembering my calculus and engineering and trigonometry circumference. Oh, the compass. I'm going all the way around. I was going this way. He'll turn you all the way around. Amen. He'll get your feet placed on solid ground. So when God became a man, he met our greatest need in the person of Jesus Christ. If my greatest need had been information, he would have sent an educator. If my greatest need had been technology, he would have sent me a scientist. If my greatest need had been money, he would have sent a banker or an economist. If my greatest need had been pleasure, he would... I can't say that. Never mind. But our greatest need was forgiveness. So God sent a Savior. Jesus came, the incarnation of the Godhead. See, that's what, when I kept studying scripture, that just behooved me. I said, wait a minute. God manifested in three persons, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. All through scripture, the Holy Spirit is spirit. Yeah, I don't know. Can you see the spirit? No. You see where the wind blows, though, that's the spirit. Right? Jesus says, ain't nobody seen God the Father. Nobody. Except me. But when you have seen me, you have seen the Father. Those passages I'm telling you to read is the ones that's telling you that he is the exact representation of the Father. That when you see Jesus, When we get to heaven and see Jesus, you see the Father. You see the Holy Spirit, because he is the manifestation, the physical manifestation of the Godhead. He is God. I told you I'm teaching this morning. So that's why Philippians was important, because it gives us a biblical expression of the incarnation. Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal to God. Although he's God, I'm going to submit to the Father. I'm going to submit to the Holy Spirit. Although I'm the Son, I ain't got to take this, but I'm going to do it anyway. Don't ask me how to explain the incarnation. I don't think nobody theologically can explain it to you. I don't know how all-powerful God can get in this body right here. But somehow he did. Because if you put just this part of God, it probably make our bodies explode. But he says, I'm going to set aside my full power. Amen. I'm going to set aside my full knowledge. I can pick it up at any time. Amen. But I'm going to live like you live. I'm going to feel what it feels like to get hungry. I'm going to feel like, mama, don't turn that way. Don't lay on that side. Lay on this side. Amen. I want to feel everything that you felt with. That's why Christ can identify with what you're going through. Christ knows when he's hungry. Christ knows, I know what it means to be tired. So sometimes Jesus is going to tell you, go take a nap. Go to bed. Amen. No, I'm going to keep, I got to keep doing this. No, you need to rest. Because Jesus, didn't he go to sleep? Didn't he eat? Didn't he get tired? And guess what? He got mad. Come in my house, my father's house, and y'all got roulette tables going on, doing all this stuff, pole dancing. What is wrong with y'all? Amen. No, you made this a den of robbers. But this should be a house of prayer. So this Jesus. So the true meaning of Christmas is a celebration of this incredible act of love, that God sent his son. Paul says it like this to the Roman church in the 5th chapter, verse 8, but God demonstrated his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. He became empty so that we can become filled. He became poor so that we would be wealthy. He gave that we might be saved. So the 5 statements in the Bible that address why God came, why God became a man. First one is Matthew 11 and 27. All things have been committed to me by my Father. No one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son, and those to whom the Son chooses to reveal. Secondly, why did God come? Second is to destroy the works of the devil. 1 John chapter 3 and 8. For this purpose, the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. Number 3, to give life. The Gospel of John, chapter 10, verse 10. The thief comes only to steal, kill, and destroy. I have come that they may have life and have it to the full. In verse 28, it says, I give them eternal life and they shall never perish. No one can snatch them out of my hand. So when I'm saved, I'm in the hand of God. I'm in the hand of Jesus. I dare you to take me out of his hand. I dare you to move a pinky. I dare you to even touch or approach his hand. You can't. So I am secure in Jesus. Fourthly, Jesus came to redeem mankind. How do you know, Pastor? Galatians chapter 4, verse 4. But when the fullness of time was come, God sent forth his son, made of a woman, made under the law, to redeem them that were under the law, that we might receive the adoptions of sons. The Bible gives clear accounts of sin into this world through Adam. But salvation came through Christ. He came to redeem what man had already messed up. What we have broken and could not fix, God says, I'll do it for you. And I'm going to do it through my son, Jesus. So Christmas means Jesus came, was incarnate into the world so that he could give himself as a ransom price to purchase our freedom. And lastly, Jesus came to save. For the Son of Man is come to seek and to save that which is lost. Luke 19 and 10. And John continues this in that first chapter. But as many as received him, to them he gave the right to become children of God, to those who believe in his name. That's what Jesus is about. This is what Christmas is about. This is what God has done through Jesus Christ for us. It is the gift. He came to save us, not to condemn us, but to save us. But it only applies if you open up your gift. It only applies if you receive the gift of salvation. It only applies if you believe in the name that is above every name. Because if you don't believe, I'm going to tell you one other thing's going to happen. Every knee will bow. Every tongue will confess. The question is, are you going to do it now or never? That's your options. Because don't wait till you get there. It's too late. So Jesus came in order to come into our hearts and lives, to make our lives rich and meaningful, to make us and change us from the inside out, to do for me what I could not do for myself. He came and he died so that we can go free and to sing Amazing Grace. How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Blind, but now I see. Thank God he came. Thank God he didn't stop. Thank God he didn't turn around. Because he was wounded for my transgression, bruised for my iniquity. And like sheep, I had turned and walked away. But God found me and brought me back. So when God came, he picked us up when we were down. When God came, he cleaned us when we were dirty. He brought us in when we were cast out. He filled us when we were empty. He gave hope in our spirits and in our lives. I guess that's why them hymn writers says, oh, precious fountain that saves from sin. I am so glad that I have entered in. There Jesus saves me and keeps me clean. Glory to his name. I'm so glad God came, that he looked beyond my faults, saw my needs, that he is my hope for life beyond the grave, that he is my bread when I'm starving in this land, that he is my joy of my salvation. He is the theme of my song. He is my Santa Claus. And I don't just get a new bike, I get a new spirit. I get a new transformed mind. I get life and life more abundantly. He made the enemies my footstool. Thank God he came. I was guilty. And he took me to the court. Overruled. Exonerated, wiped clean. Get that boy one of my robes. Put that crown on his head, because that's my son. I died for him. I paid the price for him. I've been bought. So for every valley shall be exalted, and every mountain and hill shall be made low, and the crooked shall be made straight, and the rough places plain, and the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all flesh shall see it together. For the mouth of the Lord has spoken. Glory to God in the highest. Peace on earth. So you can go wrapped around all this worldly stuff you want to. See how that worked for you. You can wrap yourself up in money. Let me tell you the secret. Money funny. You can have a lot of it and it can leave you by the next day. Let the market shift. Go on, put some money in some crypto. Put all your money in crypto. See whether you got it next week. So stuff changes. You can be happy in an environment, but once that environment goes, it gets old. You get a new car, get a second mortgage, driving your little expensive $1,200 a month payment on a car. But guess what? In 30 days, the new car smell leaves. And after that first payment, it don't look that good. Amen. But I'd rather have Jesus than silver or gold. I'd rather have Jesus because I got riches untold. I'd rather have Jesus because he's going to walk with me and talk with me. And guess what? All that other stuff, my credit cards, the banks, the IRS, everybody, the government, the president of the United States, they don't care about me. Because when cancer came, when dementia came, and Alzheimer's came, and when it claimed my family, when it took away my loved one, when stuff is wrecking my body, when nerves are going bad, when you came, do you know I love playing the guitar? I played it since I was 3 years old. But I can't play it no more. We were playing for 8 hours a night. But not to be able to make the chords, to watch your body just, what kind of mess is this? To where you had 20/20 vision, take your glasses off, you gonna hurry up and run, go find your glasses. Amen. All that stuff, I'm telling you, will leave you. But guess who won't? Jesus. When your loved ones die, see how all the stuff that the world has is going to help you. I know when my folk died, Jesus was there. He had his hand on my shoulder. When I couldn't walk, he picked me up. When I needed strength, he gave me strength. And he says, you know they with me, don't you? Yes, Lord. They not hurting no more. I got them. Now you keep going. That is power, and that's why Jesus came. Amen. So I'm telling you, y'all better believe him this morning. You better accept the gift of salvation and the gift of Christmas, the true gift, which is Christ himself. If you don't have them, as we stand for the invitation. Salvation is not hard. Well, it's impossible, but the process ain't hard. The process is if you want it. If God is speaking to you right now and you want it, all you got to do is take a step of faith. And says, yes, Lord, won't you come? If you need to grow in your faith, I'm telling you, we're going to grow here at St. Paul. We're going to get into this word. We're going to understand what it is, and we're going to utilize it in our lives. So there is no fear. Not no more. Won't you come? Is that all this morning? Wait a minute. I told you, this is the end of the year. I ain't going through 2024 like 2023. That's not happening. Not after what he's given us.
Yes, sir.
I want it. And I want you to have it too.
Yes.
But how is not going to happen? If you just sitting there. You know that crap is going in your life. You know what's happening. I know I'm not the only one that's mad and frustrated. I'm not the only one that's going through a season. Right now, it might be sunshiny. Well, God bless you. Good luck. But guess what? It ain't going to last. Yeah. Telling you ain't going to last. You better grow up. Because I've seen it be sunshiny a couple of days and then rain come. It's seasons going to change. The question is, are you ready? Amen? And I'm trying to get my people ready. You think 2024 going to be easy? He coming back. I ain't talking about Jesus. I'm talking about who controls the Republican Party. He coming back. Once he get back, what you think he going to do? They couldn't stop him before. What you think he gonna do when he come back now? What you think they doing to you right now? Gentrification, rezoning, taxes. Amen. Have you noticed your taxes went up? And then they diverting those tax funds to the charter schools and they private schools and depriving the public schools where the minorities are and taking our money. Okay, you act like it ain't gonna be no problem. If it ain't no problem for you, fine. Go right ahead. But you know what Pastor gonna do?
Top of a hill. Don't give me the world with a shallow thrill, but just give me a savior. My life he can hold. I'd rather have Jesus than silver and gold. Woke up this morning feeling kind of down. I called on my best friend I'd rather have Jesus than silver and gold.
Ask and it shall be given, seek and you shall find, knock and the door will be open. For everybody else, I expect you got it. So I expect to see what I see in Scripture. I expect to see the behavior. I expect to see the giving. I expect to see the participation. I expect to see you love one another as you love yourself, since you got it. And if it's not, somebody lying. Amen. So if you got it, I expect power. If you don't have the power, I expect you to have sense enough to ask God for it. Because you will be held accountable. And I'm not going to say just because you said it, that settles it. No, I want to see it. Just like you look at me, I'm looking at you too. I want to see power. He done sent you the pastor to fight this battle. I'm not losing. They're not winning. It's not happening. Not when Christ came to give us the victory, it is not happening. I'm not backing down from death. I'm not backing down from cancer. I'm not backing down from whatever Satan throw. You take your best shot. I'm going to stay with Jesus. Make sure you get it. Prepare our hearts for the lifting of our tithes and offering. Also, Pastor wants to give a shout out to everyone that gave us shout outs for our, Sister Jenkins and I. We celebrated on December the 22nd, 33 years. Yeah, yeah, yeah. 33, son. Yeah. Well, she put up with me 33 years. God gonna give her a VIP award and crowns and stuff and jump. But it's been a wonderful journey. I'm still at the altar saying, what happened? Why is it kids in our house? Where are all these people coming from? But it's been a wonderful journey. So we had a wonderful celebration. Every day is a celebration. Amen. With the one you love, every day is a celebration. The one you love. Amen. So we had a good time.
Oh, y'all look so Christmassy.
Hey, family. And all the extended family that came back for Christmas. Oh, this is so awesome. And I can't wait for Christmas dinner. Ooh, that girl can cook too. Ooh. Put some of that Mississippi mud in it. It's something. It's good. And them turnip greens been cooking all day. That was the best time of Christmas for me, even growing up, is being with my brothers and sisters and mama and daddy and giving gifts. I was an entrepreneur, so I got what I wanted all year anyway, so that didn't matter. My thing was giving gifts and finding out what mom and daddy and Butch and Mary and them wanted, and then I save up, then I have my money and I go buy that gift, and I wrap my own, thank you very much, because you wrap it messy. I don't like that. It's too much tape on there, no. And wrapping the gifts and putting them under the tree, that was fun. And then eating. Oh, my Lord. And for some of you out there that can't cook turkey, stop it. Don't embarrass yourself like that.
Oh, I guess y'all waiting on me. Oh, sit down. Amen. Father, we thank you for coming. We thank you for your advent and your incarnation. We thank you that you come to bring life and life more abundantly. We thank you for all of the gifts that you've given us, not one day a year, but each and every day. Help us, Lord, to unwrap those gifts, to receive them, and to read the instruction manual of how to use them effectively in our lives. I thank you that our cup never runs empty, that it constantly overflows, and let it overflow in abundance. Let our love overflow. Let our joy overflow until it reaches each and every person we come in contact with. Thank you for this gift. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday, Jesus.
Amen.